The major one is, of course, enteric diarrheal diseases. When I first joined the department, we had outbreaks due to things like salmonella, typhoid, pretty big ones and interesting ones. There was some outbreak in IMH. You can imagine how hard to control. But since then, I think the last interesting one was paratyphi outbreak in 1997 or 1993. I can't remember. That was the last interesting one. Since then, I don't think any outbreaks. Then I think also STD. And I think that's about it. Well, I guess with the rehousing, when we got rid of the slums and people moved on to better housing, all the enteric infections definitely fell. Didn't see any more large major outbreaks. And other than that, for respiratory, we had the odd body teller, but I think for the last decade, more than a decade, we haven't had any. So I think that's about it, the change in the pattern. Well, when I first started, we had cultures, bacterial cultures, and we had TB cultures. Bacterial cultures are very simple, on blood culture plates and some selective media of the run-of-the-mill bacteria like your enterobacteriaceae, some of the non-fermentatives like your pseudomonas and your acinetos. But since then, you know, it has improved by leaps and bounds. Now we have a lot of rapid tests as well as molecular tests and also automated machines that can do a lot. So I think that has really changed the face of microbiology in many ways. But with automated machines, one must be careful, you see, because sometimes it comes out totally wrong. Like now we have machines to do identification and susceptibility testing. Then you know sometimes the ID is totally off. Sometimes the susceptibility testing does not take in all the different mechanisms that you are very familiar with. Now you're the expert in it. So in that sense, we still need good experienced technicians. You just cannot rely on the machine 100% because it'll throw you off totally. Then of course we have all molecular tests which has changed the field of microbiology. Because tests are rapid, results are fast, patients get treated, they can leave the hospital faster, we free up beds. So it's a win-win situation for all. And I see that as a growing field, unless some other newer methods come in the future. That's human nature, that's human nature. You know, from cultures where you wait a few days, now you get it in 1 or 2 hours, there's a marked difference. But you pay the price for it too, because it's more expensive than your run-of-the-mill culture is that susceptibility. Well, I guess a curiosity, microbiologist. Well, a curiosity to find out the cause of something. Then you must have the interest for laboratory work. Because if you don't like laboratory work, then forget it, you'll be bored stiff. But I would encourage people to give it a try because it is a very interesting field. And it, although we have all the old methods, as you can see, it's evolving all the time. And now we have newer pathogenic organisms coming up. Maybe someone can discover something new. When I first started, there were no infectious disease physicians. But Jimmy and I, Dr. Jimmy Sung and I, were very, very keen because we knew we could not do the clinical. We are not trained, and besides, we were needed in the lab. There were very, very few clinical microbiologists. So we were very enthusiastic about introducing it. And the first person was Dr. Helen Oh, and she was very keen. So we encourage her, we encourage Wong Sin Yu, we encourage Brenda. These were the three. And then David Allen came along, and then now you all are doing very well. You have got a big team, but it's much needed. No, in the, I think in the mid-80s, we started recognizing that it was increasing. And that was when we started just, rather than calling it just Staph aureus, we highlighted actually as MRSA. And also in conjunction in the late 80s, we saw the consumption of vancomycin going up because of Staph, MRSA. So because of that, I think we worked very closely with infection control and tried our very best. But in the early days, infection control was quite different. We had linen towels, and they only change about once or twice a day. So you can know, although your hands are washed and clean, you might be recontaminating them again. So we had a hard time convincing actually administration to change. So they changed at first to paper towels. And when all these MRSA increased and also Acinetobacter started increasing, they saw the need to introduce Hibiscus scrub, because Hibiscus scrub was expensive compared to your bar of soap. But again, administration said, oh, a lot of money. So they limited it to the ICUs only. Then as the resistance increased, MRSA and Acinetobacter and a few others increased, soon it was hospital-wide. So now it's hospital-wide. But in the early days, it was very, very hard to convince them because it was a matter of cost, dollars and cents. Which I guess if you're sitting at that end, you also can understand. I'm speaking in terms of SGH. I'm not sure when the other hospitals introduced paper towels and Hibiscus scrub hospital-wide. So I can't speak for them, only SGH. I don't, because I think of a laboratory end. So, but I knew that administration started taking note of it. Initially, MRSA, when we said to isolate, they gave them corner beds only. You see, whereas in UK, they had single beds and things like that. But the single beds were reserved for A-class. Then when the MRSA became more, they decided to cohort them. So we had them in cohorted wards, and those that had MRSA of wounds that were easily covered were left in the general ward, depending on the bed situation. And that's about it, because beds were so precious, they didn't want to give one whole sort of isolation. But I think now it has changed. The big thing they did actually was for burns. Burns had a big problem with Acinetobacter, and it was such a big problem as ST Lee was tearing his hair. And finally, they did something to the air exchangers and had one site for resistant bacteria. And I think that was very good, really. I don't know now. I guess the thing is mainly viruses now. You see. I think we learned a very good lesson from SARS. So everybody knows more or less what to do, because this is not the first time we've been through. And I think Singapore has been anticipating things like MERS and things like that. So I think we have got our act going, and restructured hospitals and all have very good infection control teams. And compared to the early days, you know, I don't know whether do you know what happened in the early days when we first started infection control? We only had one assistant nurse, and she was quite terrified to go to the wards because the sisters and all the staff nurses considered her a spy. So when they came in, they would say, the spy is here or something of the sort. So she was very cowed by them. And how can one nurse do surveillance for a 1,600-bed hospital? But ministry wanted statistics. So we played the game, and we did it in rotation. And when she went on leave, we had no statistics. And all this was submitted to MOH. I don't know what the other hospitals were doing, but I think you have to take all the early days results with a big pinch of salt. But we have improved since then, and now we have got very good, a very strong team, I think, in all the restructured hospitals.